Hi, my name is Dennis Lawrence Jr. and I am the co-director, along with Shirley Byers, of the Dartmouth High School Theater Company. And we are ready to welcome you back to live theater, to come into our auditorium and see an incredible Christmas show called Christmas in New England, which I was fortunate enough to have written, which is different vignettes of families over the years telling us about their Christmas and holiday traditions. And what we've done is we've brought them into our theater and entwined it with holiday music that you will know and love and be tapping your toes and clapping and singing along with. And we're very excited to have you come back.
Hi, my name is Gabriella Reardon. I started theater in kindergarten. I've done South Coast Children's Theater for my whole childhood, and now I've come here, and it's just kind of something that really stuck with me. I love everything about theater. I love the music. I love the performance art. Our characters, we're kind of playing ourselves, and each scene is kind of a different scenario. We're so used to getting a script and reading about the character, and then you have a set way of how this person is and how you're supposed to play them. Playing yourself, it might seem easy because you're playing you and you know yourself, but you have more space to really play around with what you're doing and how you're feeling and what your character feels.
Hi, my name is Gracie Rose. I started theater when I was 8 years old in this theater company. A friend of mine, her older cousin, was in the show, and they needed younger children to come in and play, and I fell in love with it and being on stage, and I've been here ever since. It's just been a really big part of my life.
Hi, my name is Tyler Bro. I'm a sophomore here at DHS, and I'm currently part of the production on Christmas in New England. I started acting in sixth grade at Dartmouth Middle School when I heard they were doing a Lion King Jr., and ever since then I've really enjoyed it, and I just kept doing it. I enjoy the holidays, so I'm definitely bringing that energy into my character, because everyone does play themselves, but everyone brings their own unique traits.
So we need you now more than ever. We have been without a show at Dartmouth High School since we shut down in March of 2019. So almost 2 years later, our kids are excited to be able to come and perform for you. Our seating is reduced. Now that's important to remember, because we sell our shows out every year, and we're not able to do that this time. So it's tickets that are on a first-come, first-served basis at a reduced number. And you do have to wear a mask when you come to see this production. If you want to come see this show, don't miss out.
I like being together as a family, our theater company, because last year and the year before, we didn't really get to have that. But now we get to kind of all be together and spend time together and stuff. And that's just, for me, that's one of the reasons why I love theater so much, is that you have this, group of people who you get to see almost every day, and you have this common interest, so that's probably my favorite part about doing a show.
We're bringing our own Christmas traditions into it. The way that Dennis wrote the show, it's supposed to be very personalized and just bringing out the true meaning of Christmas to all of us as individuals in the cast.
I definitely think people can relate to this play really well. It's got a lot of good Christmas traditions, music, and just great scenes. I think people will be easy to relate to this, whether it's from past experiences or new experiences.
So Christmas in New England, a musical review, will take place on December 2nd, 3rd, and 4th. There are evening performances at 7 p.m., and there is a Saturday matinee at 1 p.m. The tickets are $15 per adult and $12 for students and seniors. And you can call and make a reservation. You can buy the tickets at the door, if they're still there, and or you can also order our tickets online by visiting our website, which is dhstheaterco.com. Everyone knows, with what we've been through over the last 2 years, we need a little Christmas. Our kids need a little Christmas, our kids need your support, and we need you to come here, and we need you to help bring in the holidays with us. Christmas in New England, Dartmouth High School Theater Company, don't miss it.
I'd just like to welcome everybody to our rally today and thank everybody for coming and all the people that supported you guys and put this event on. One thing I want to say is we have a big tradition. It goes back to the 20s. We're playing Fairhaven in football. And some years they beat us and other years we beat them. My grandfather always used to say, score as many points as you can and don't stop. We have 14 seniors on the team, and they promise to play as hard as they possibly can for four quarters and get a victory over Fairhaven. Have a great time. Our student section was outstanding all year, and I expect you guys to be at the game tomorrow. Thank you very much. Be Fairhaven!
Introducing them, we have Ace and Aiden. Now let's give it up for Dartmouth High's football team.
I'm too sexy for this girl, too sexy for your girl, too sexy for this world, too sexy for this ice, too sexy for that jet. Yeah, yeah, I'm too sexy.
Peace up, A-Town down.
She had me feeling like she's ready to blow.
Guess who's back? Back again. See, he's back. Tell a friend.
By Dartmouth Hall of Famer Jim Thompson. Andy Thompson will be joining us in a couple of minutes. And this year's game, Jim, one of the things we like about it is that you have two teams with great records, and we could have a great game, something that we really haven't had too much over this decade.
Yeah, I would agree with that, Paul. Both teams coming in with a record of 7-3, and we have three of the area's top offensive performers in this game. On the Dartmouth side, Will Kelly, he's the engine that makes the offense go. He's the quarterback, and Ethan Marks. You folks at home, you have to watch Ethan. He's a 1950s, 1960s kind of running back. Just runs into the defense, and he likes to hit before the defense hits him. So between Kelly and Marks, they had about 1,900 yards between them, which I think is a school record, other than Jordan Todman doing what he did about 5 or 6 years ago. So I'm looking forward to it. Should be a good one.
And how about on the other side of the ball, the Fairhaven Cadence Chase, 19 touchdowns on the season, setting a school record. So, you know, they're confident over there at Fairhaven. They're looking at it like, hey, we haven't won this thing in a while. We think we can go over there and take this one.
Yeah, I haven't seen them play. They run an option offense. The head coach, over there now was Dana Olmeda's son, and Dana had many a brawl with the Indians on Thanksgiving morning running the wishbone back then, and so did Coach Lynch. So I was privileged on the night prior to the game on Wednesday. We used to go to a certain little place, the coaches or whatever, and I got invited. It was great to see Coach Lynch and Dana Olmeda talking about the next day's game, and they still do the same thing. They did it yesterday. The coaches get together, so the staffs are very friendly, which makes this game even more entertaining.
Well, Jim and I, along with Andy, will be heading up to the booth. Right now we're going to turn it over to the national champion, Dartmouth High School Marching Band, and then it'll be time for Thanksgiving football.
Rebecca Brago. Band led by student conductors Lauren Sullivan, Erin Thatcher, and Lexi Arruda. Dartmouth High School is proud to present the Dartmouth High School Marching Band.
Dartmouth High School Indians. At center, number 50, Ann Martin. At right guard, number 55, Captain Josh Miller. At right tackle, number 75, Parker Souza. At left guard, number 62, Chase Lackey. At left tackle, number 65, Ellie Johnson. At quarterback, number 4, Captain Will Kelly. At running back, running back, number 34, Captain Ethan Mark.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Thanksgiving to one and all in the town of Dartmouth and our live viewers on YouTube. We welcome you to this telecast of Dartmouth High School football. This morning, it's the traditional Thanksgiving Day game between Fairhaven and Dartmouth. Great to have Andy Thompson alongside, Paul Santos, as well as my broadcast partners. And once again, happy Thanksgiving to everyone watching this game. Paul Santos, in the pregame show, we talked about the team's records, and this should be a very, very good game. And not only that, talented players on both rosters.
Yeah, absolutely. Should be a lot of fun to watch both the Dartmouth Indians and the Fairhaven Losers because they have a lot of senior leadership on both sides, a lot of experience, a lot of players that can execute, not only the down linesmen, but also in defensively, the linebackers, the corners up front, the offensive lines. And, of course, they have the skill position players to put points on the board, led by Cadence Chaser for Haven with the season-leading and also career-leading 19 touchdowns, another six with Peter Chase. Peter Chase is the guy in the truck. six touchdowns for him. And, of course, on the Dartmouth side, Will Kelly and Ethan Marks, the touchdown makers. So you add all that up, and we should have a very entertaining and close football game between these rivals.
Andrew, you played in this game. What does it mean for the departing seniors?
Well, I mean, it means a ton. I mean, most of these guys played 4 years. They played all together. Both sides know each other between summer camps and whatnot. It's a big game. Families are here. It's a great day to celebrate with everybody. So it means a lot to these kids, and it'll be the last time majority of them suit up for their career.
And we do have a little interesting little tidbit for you folks that haven't really seen a lot of these teams. Fairhaven's school record holder, Cadence Chase. Tell us about him.
Cadence Chase was once a Dartmouth resident. I believe he still is a Dartmouth resident and has school choice in Fairhaven. He's going over there, has had a great career over there, great season. I believe he'd be up for the Otto Graham Award this year compared to Will Kelly and maybe Ethan Marks or Dartmouth. So, you know, on the ground, he's unstoppable, kind of like Will Kelly style. So it should be a good game on both sides.
Yeah, that's a little cool little tidbit, Paul, that the young man was an Indian at one time. I believe during the COVID pandemic, he decided to go back to his hometown of Fairhaven and has had quite a career.
Well, you know, you could say it's a friendly rivalry, and I'm sure it is a friendly rivalry. He knows players, of course, here at Dartmouth. Of course, he now has gotten very close with the players there in Fairhaven. But from his point of view, I think there's no question about the fact that he's looking back and saying, hey, you know, we're no joke over here. I want to lead our team over my friends over there in Dartmouth as sort of a friendly rivalry type thing. How important and how nice would that be for him to show his ex-teammates that, hey, we're doing something over here as well.
And, Andrew, a good season for Dartmouth High School. We had the pleasure of calling the game up in Milton. The Indians making the playoffs once again. It wasn't a great game. Milton was really good. And I wasn't here last week, fellas, but the Indians bounced back from that game with a victory over Plymouth North.
Yeah, it was a good game for them. The Indians really put it all together. We had a nice crowd out here that day, and they did a lot of things well that day. Will Kelly and Ethan Marks leading the charge that time defensively. They did a great job. Dan Martin was really great on defense that day. And Dylan in the backfield there, number one, he had a great game. As a matter of fact, Dylan Gomes not only with a big interception to shut down what would have been a very close, I don't know if it was going to be a tying touchdown, but it was going to get Plymouth North back into the game. He had an interception, and then he had a great fourth down takeaway, knocking the ball away on their fourth down attempt late in the game. So a couple of great plays by him really helped close the door on Plymouth North.
Well, let's set it down field side. The Dartmouth High School award-winning band, it's a national anthem. As always, by the Dartmouth High School Marching Band. Another great season for the band. Another national championship.
You know, every single year, as you look at that Dartmouth sideline, when you talk about the Dartmouth Band, it's almost like if you don't win the whole thing, it's almost disappointing. Well, they haven't disappointed us again under the direction of Ian Flynn. They come through with another title nationally here for the Dartmouth Indians.
Well, Andrew, any predictions on this one?
Well, I know Lori Loeb said it, 35-34 Fairhaven. I just don't see Fairhaven putting up 34 points. I told you yesterday, I predict the Indians by 18 today.
All right, Paul?
I'm going to say 21-7, 21-14 Dartmouth. And the reason why I say that is I do think Dartmouth is going to win the game. Again, I think the senior leadership over here, the amount of athletes that they have, the fact that they have more senior athletes than side with all the talent over there, I think the Indians are going to pull it off. And the other thing too, I agree with Andrew, you know, these teams are running teams, right? So how in the world are they going to combine for 70 points? I mean, I don't see it. Unless she has something that we don't have or knows something that we don't know, she's covered these teams all year. I mean, in order to have that kind of point total, you basically have to have the defenses not stop anybody all game. So I don't know. I don't see it. But, hey, that's why we play the game. Let's see if she knows something that we don't.
Okay, Fairhaven will kick it away. The Indians will receive. High and over end kick, and that is Crane from his own goal line. Crane's got a little running room up the middle of the field, still on his feet as he crosses the 25 and finally taken down at about the 30-yard line where the Indians will have it first and 10 off a 30-yard opening kickoff return.
Well, you know, Coach Belichick likes to talk about the three phases of the game, and he just hammers away all the time with that. Well, that's the reason right there. You know, special teams can really make or break you, and today might be the day, not only with, you know, things like extra points and two-point conversions, but right there on the kickoff return.
Will Kelly is the Indian quarterback. 17 rushing touchdowns on the season. And here's Dutra. And Dutra's got running room up across the 45 out to the 48-yard line. Gain of 13 and an Indian first down. Brought down by Cadence Chase.
Well, it's a nice run there by Dutra. This is really something because, you know, you look at the stat sheet, and it's Will Kelly and Ethan Marks really doing probably 85% of the ball carrying. But no, they go to Dutra, who's very, very capable, has had some great runs on the year, and he gets a first down with a huge gain. First play from scrimmage for Green.
Yeah, Paul, that was a play they started to run pretty successfully against Milton a couple weeks back. That during that game, they really didn't have much offense going, but Dutra is one of those guys who get that play going as a fourth-year senior. Good to see him get a carry, cut up field, and get an early first down for the Indians.
We have an injured Blue Devil down. That's Nolan Aruda. And he just
and
gets
Nolan
up now.
He's able to walk off the field under his own power.
And being assisted by the trainer, and hopefully the young fellow will be fine.
Well, we have a chance. The officials, the referee is Randy Braga, Nuno Barros, Clint Cabral, Cam Crawford, Dustin Cormier, and Sean Myers on the staff today here on Thanksgiving morning.
First and 10 Indians from midfield. Just underway here from the stadium. And here's Marks, his first carry of the game, and Ethan breaks a tackle. Ethan heading down to the 40, inside the 40, still on his feet, and inside the 35-yard line down to the 33, where Kevin Mora finally made the tackle in the secondary.
Byron Dutra here springs the block, top of your screen number 13 from Ethan Marks, gets him to the outside. Marks, again, we've talked about all year long, runs hard, feet always moving. Nice first down for the Indians.
Two runs, two first downs. Here's Marks again over the left side, and Ethan picks up a couple of tacklers there. Tyler Mahorn, first guy to get him down to the ground. Gain of five, and bring up second and short here now for Dartmouth.
Well, looking back at Ethan Marks, 10 touchdowns on the season rushing for the Dartmouth Indians. Will Kelly, 14, and Will has also thrown six touchdown passes. The offense on a roll to start.
And here's Kelly off the ball fake. Ekes his way down to the 25-yard line. It's going to be about a yard and a half, 2 yards short. Bring up third down.
A nice play by the Fairhaven defender there. I think it was Jason Dutra. Stayed home, read Will Kelly well on that play. Didn't go for the read option there. Stayed home. Nice play.
Will Kelly, very capable, certainly. A great athlete, really able to ad lib. This is the first time now in this very short drive that the Indians are facing a third and short.
And here's the pitch to Ethan, and Marks is going to be very close to the first down, and they're going to give it to him. First down, Dartmouth. Third first down of the opening drive.
Give it to the workhorse all season long. Ethan Marks gets upfield quick always in this offense and gets the first down for the Indians.
Yeah, early in the game, but clearly four down territory. If you didn't get it there, the Indians were going to go for it. So really a nice opportunity for the Indians here to get on the board first on their first drive as they are quickly in the red zone.
First and 10 from the Fairhaven 22 is Esterlin. Esterlin has running room, still on his feet. J.J. heading down toward the goal line. He's going to be just short. His first carry of the ball game.
J.J.'s had a good season running inside compared to early on the season running outside. Hard runner gets up the hole there and gets down to about the 1 yard line. Nice run by J.J. Good to see.
Great execution by the Indians so far. That's a 20-yard gain on Esterlin's first carry of the ball game.
Peter Joseph saved the touchdown. Indians first and goal. And that's in for a touchdown. Ethan Marks puts the Indians ahead 6-0. And for Marks, that's his 11th touchdown of the season.
Exactly how you want to finish off the first drive of the game. Depend on your seniors between J.J., Will Kelly, and Marks. It's a great first drive for the Indians. Great to see start of the game for the offense of the Indians.
Oliver Taradash in now for the point after touchdown. So far, so good. The kick is up. And it's good. So with 9:22 to go here in the opening quarter, the Indians take it in. They lead 7-0. Let's check out a senior spotlight.
My name is Oliver Taradash, and I'm the kicker. My favorite memory was just buckling up the helmet with all my boys and going to every game. Teamwork means a lot, never give up, and just show up on time is the most thing. Showing up is half the battle. Fairhaven game means a lot to us. It's been a battle for like over 100 years, and with the win would mean the world to everyone.
Hi, my name is Zach Sylvia. I'm a wide receiver and a safety. I chose to play football because I've always been a huge fan of it. I've always been interested in the game. I've been probably playing since maybe like third grade, and I've always loved it since then. Planning to go to college, probably studying communications. My favorite memory had to be against Bishop Stang when we beat him 35-0. I had the first tackle of the game on kickoff, so it was always a good memory. I've lived in Dartmouth my entire life, so this game's always big. It really doesn't matter how good each team is, it's always a dogfight.
This kicks it away for Dartmouth High. The ball takes one hop to Chase.
Chase on the return.
And he's brought down just shy of the 20.
Close call there with the Blue Devils. The ball kind of takes an awkward hop off the kick, and Chase able to scoop it up and secure it. Nice tackle by Chase Fennell on the play.
The top athlete right there, Caden Stace, getting the ball in his hands is never a bad idea, of course, on special teams as well, offensively, defensively, and special teams. But what a huge mistake that would have been. He picked it up and ran. Almost thought maybe he should have just covered it, but he retained possession.
Get our first look at Fairhaven this morning. Peter Joseph, 6 touchdowns on the season, is the quarterback.
For the Blue Devils.
And on the very first play, they might have got Dartmouth to jump.
It's going to be a defensive line for the Indians defense. They need to be solid today. They need to be, you know, on their game. They can't be jumping. They can't be moving. They have to stay home, play the gaps, watch the quarterback. This is a tricky offense to watch. So hopefully Dartmouth is ready to go and play on the defensive line.
Colby Carrier went in motion one way, then reversed himself, and that led the interior lineman to jump offside. So it'll be first down at 5 now for the Blue Devils.
First and 5,
this is their opening drive.
Fairhaven on their own 24-yard line.
And they hand it right up the middle. Danny Martin there for the Indians.
Justin Marks on the carry.
Marks Martin was the ball carrier. For the Indians. Picked up a yard. Second down and 4.
Will be second and 4.
Tell you, coaches talk a lot about turnovers and penalties. That last game that Dartmouth had against Plymouth North, Plymouth North shot themselves in the foot a number of times. Keep an eye on that stat.
We see Carrier did it as well that time. Started in motion, and then they looked to the sideline to get the play. That's Chase in motion. Here's the pitch. And a nice job out there by the Indians on the perimeter.
Nice job by Will Kelly there, staying home, making the play in the open field.
That was Carrier, the ball carrier.
Carrier on the carry.
He's shy by about a yard.
It will be third and 1. Devil,
Will Kelly getting in there, making a contribution to that tackle.
And they run it here on third down, and they're going to pick up the first down.
Well, this offense is tricky to see who has the ball. That's what's number 25, Justin Marks, for Fairhaven getting the ball
Patrick
up the middle.
The
you know, Fairhaven can run it up the middle, but you got to watch those tricky options to the outside. You don't want to get beat on the outside. A lot of discipline to stay home on the ends. Luckily, you have Aruda, Byron Duch out there, who's played 4 years here. He knows what he's doing out there.
Marks is only a freshman. Impressive. 4 touchdowns on the season for the Fairhaven Blue Devils.
And again, they pitch it wide side of the field. And that's going to be a gain of 8. So Fairhaven attacking the perimeter that time. Colby Carrier, the ball carrier.
This is going to be the problem all day with the Fairhaven offense. They get to the outside. They have a good quarterback who's a great athlete and a great running back. So got to stay home and be disciplined again. It's just all discipline with this kind of offense without read options and get to the corners.
Second and 3 here now for Fairhaven. And they give it to the wing back, and he's going to be very close to the first down. That was Chase, the ball carrier.
Met by a host of Indians, led by Ethan Marks.
You know, I don't think we've seen either team get thrown for a loss yet. I mean, even when you know, the defense played it well. There was still a 2-3 yard gain, and, you know, the offenses are going to be content with that most of the time.
Chase in motion. Here he comes here to the near side. The Indians surround him and take him down at the 45-yard line. Ethan Marks there to make the tackle for the Indians.
Nice play by Ethan Marks here. Nice play by Devin Wilson as well. Chase him down and save that pursuit to the outside, getting the ball back inside compared to letting him cut up the field and get a big gain. Nice play.
Here's a good look at Ethan Marks, a senior. It's time for Havens wants to spread the field on this offensive play. Two receivers to the top of your screen. Chase, Career, and Marks are the wingbacks. And this is a pitch here to the near side. And out to midfield goes Cadence Chase. Gain of 4 on the play. It'll bring up...
Played by Gomes here on the outside by himself on an island, making the open field tackle. Nice play.
Dylan Gomes coming in there, contributing to that tackle. And really, that was a slow and developing play. It felt like it took forever to do what they needed to do. And by the time they did all that, the Indians were all over it. Look at this. A 3rd down and 5. Really good position here for the Dartmouth Indians right now. Let's see what Fairhaven draws up to try to get the 1st down. Not deep enough to be in 4-down territory.
Joseph on the pitch, and this is Career. And Career is down to the Indian 40-yard line. Gain of 8 in a 1st down.
Well, that was not a slow developing play. That one, they really got it out quick to the outside. And as you said, Andy, dangerous out there.
It's dangerous, and they do a good job in blockers on the defenders getting an open, wide open gap there for the defender to get through the hole, get up for the 1st down. Nice play, good technique out there.
And the 1st quarter flying by as we approach the 5-minute mark left to play in the opening quarter. Joseph looks to throw. Here comes the rush, and he's off to the races down the far sideline. He's got a gain of 11 and a 1st down as he's knocked across the boundary, and a couple of flags come flying in as well.
You can see Joseph is a lot like Will Kelly. He can make plays on his feet when there's nothing there. Late, I don't want to say late hit, but I mean there's momentum going that way, and late flags come flying in. And we'll give Fairhaven 15 extra yards closer to the end zone.
I think there was Patrick Crane on the tackle. They're going to give him a personal foul on the late hit. March the football down to the 15-yard line. So, Paul, both teams looking sharp on their opening drives.
Yes, Dartmouth coming down and scoring in just over a minute and really using their talented running game, and now Fairhaven is doing the same the other way. I'll tell you, on that last play, it really looked like the quarterback, Peter Joseph, was going to unload it, and he had Burleson down in the end zone.
And before the play gets off, we have a timeout called by the Indian sideline. Andrew, you impressed thus far with the Fairhaven offense?
I am. And nothing has really changed between Rudy Bulger and this new head coach. However, I think Dartmouth has some PTSD from the trick plays we used to run. And I think the Dartmouth defensive coaches are always going to be on their toes, ready for something wacky to come through, a halfback pass, fake punts. I think there's always something in the back of Dartmouth's head that something's going to happen in this game that's going to turn it upside down. And we've seen it over the last couple of years when fake punts, fake field goals, weird formations. So anything's possible this game. I think the Dartmouth defense needs to be on their toes the entire game.
Fairhaven having good success running to the wide side of the field on the perimeter, off the pitch. So up the middle, not so much. Wide side runs, pretty good.
Yeah, and that's when those defensive backs and linebackers got to get off their blocks. They got to shed the blocks and get, you know, to the quarterback, make him pitch early or make him hang on to it and just read and get, you know, turn him back inside with the pursuit coming. That's basically
First
all you got to do.
First and 10, Blue Devils. 15 yards away from pay dirt. Chase in motion, he's got the pitch.
Chase on the carry.
Looking to get the corner, avoids the first tackle, but is slammed down for just a yard gain. He ran into his own teammate, Ethan Marks.
Yeah, just like we just talked about. Marks with the pursuit. Gomes got off the block to turn back inside. Nice play by the Indians there. That's all you got to do on those pitch plays is read your keys and shut the blocks.
Ball is on the 14-yard line.
It is intriguing, Paul, for Caden Chase to come back and play on this field against his own teammates.
Yeah, you got to think that he's thinking, hey, you know, I really want to beat this team. I mean, you want to beat this team anyway. You're for Haven and everything, but go back there and, you know, show these other guys, hey, we got something going over there in Fairhaven.
This time Joseph will keep it, and he may get a yard, if that. Will Kelly in there to make the stop.
And
they're going to be looking, Paul, at third and seven.
Yeah, this is really an opportunity here for the Dartmouth defense to slow these guys down and keep them out of the end zone. I mean, this is the red zone. This is where Fairhaven needs to score. And there's the defense making a great play there and stuffing them, creating up this third down and seven situation for Fairhaven.
And Joseph tried the right side. No gain there. Baron Dutra came up, made the stop.
As Paul said, this was another slow-developing kind of play. The different formation they had to come back to the short side of the field. Good play by Dutra to read that and not let the pitch get off in time. So big fourth down, first time of the game.
Andrew, did you notice that Paul used the term stuffed?
I did.
That made me hungry. I need turkey and gravy now, Paul. Thank you.
It's only the first quarter.
Oh, we got a field goal here.
They're going to try a field goal.
I was wondering about the kicking game. Yeah, they got Tyler Burke, is it?
It is.
Tyler Burke.
Kyle Figueredo to attempt a field goal.
Good snap. Kick on its way.
No good. Good.
And it's good.
Kick is good.
So Fairhaven, off their initial drive of the ball game, takes it down, kicks the field goal. Let's go to a senior spotlight. 7-3 Indians.
My name is Will Kelly, and I play quarterback. I've been playing football since I was 5 years old. Football has always been my favorite sport. I've had a special connection with football. I just felt like it's always like the most emotionally attached sport. My favorite memory was that staying game. Week one, beat them 35-0. It was a special night. As far as I can remember, I always went to the Fairhaven Dartmouth game. I always felt like it was a part of Thanksgiving, something to look forward to.
My name is Parker Souza, and I play offensive tackle and defensive tackle. I chose to play football because I really thought the sport was cool when I watched it growing up. I've been playing this game since I was 5 years old, so 12 years now. After I graduate high school, I plan to go to BCC. I've learned a lot of life lessons through football, hard work, never give up, try your hardest. My Thanksgiving Day traditions is watch football games and eat food.
Fairhaven set the kickoff. 27-yard field goal was good. Score is now 7-3, and this kick is along the far sideline. That's Crane, who's just going to turn around and fall on the football. Return the first opening kickoff, 30 yards. That time, kind of like a squib kick, Andrew. Tough to pick up.
Yeah, it's wacky. You know, you can tell the Dartmouth special teams had a lot of hands guys up front. You never know with this team and what they're going to do. So Crane hasn't really returned that many kicks this year, but he's a safety guy back there, smart enough to know just to jump on it once he didn't catch it cleanly. So.
You know, Larry Lewis had predicted this one-point game, right? And I was thinking to myself, in those kind of games, right, special teams really can be important. So you see Oliver Taradash kicking that extra point, and now Tyler Burke kicking this field goal for Fairhaven. Wow, at the end of the game, you're going to look back and say, those are important.
Here's Mox on the first down. Carey plunges his way across the 20 and out to the 21-yard line. Nice, solid run by Ethan.
Absolutely. I think this is a big drive for the Fairhaven defense. I don't know if they want to get down 14-3 this early in the game. The passing game, I don't know how well they pass the ball, to be honest with you, but I don't think you want to get in a shootout with this Dartmouth offense right now. They're getting 5 to 6 yards of carry.
And a big stop by the Indian defense, Paul, in that last Fairhaven series.
Yeah, absolutely important. It hold them to a field goal, but I was impressed that Fairhaven came up with some points on that, though, because many high school teams would not have come up with anything.
Here's Kelly. Kelly across the far sideline, and that looks like a late hit, but no flag. But more importantly, an Indian first down.
Absolutely. It looks like somebody injured over there. Will Kelly's down.
Yeah, Will Kelly is down across the far sideline.
It was about a 10-yard gain there for the Dartmouth Indian offense. Never good to see anyone down, but Will Kelly slow to get up. Still over there.
Not sure who comes in for Dartmouth at this point.
Will Kelly, a real leader on this team this year, as we pointed out at the beginning of the telecast. A senior with 14 touchdowns rushing on the season and 6 touchdown passes, and has really been the backbone of the Dartmouth Indian offense, of course, from that quarterback position.
And I got a stat sent to me this week from the coaching staff that said Will Kelly has 970 yards on the season rushing, and Ethan Marks had 958 yards on the season. So both of them are in reach of 1,000 for the season. The last duo to do that was Jordan Tauman and Jared Santos.
Good company.
And before them was Corey Catelli and Kyle Audette did that. So all good company there for these two guys. If they actually can reach 1,000, hopefully Will can get back on the field and hopefully get that 1,000 yards for himself.
And that's not even mentioning the contribution on defense. He's done a great job on the other side of the ball all year long.
Absolutely.
Okay, let's throw it down for a senior spotlight.
My name is James Martin, and I play wide receiver and DB. I chose to play football because I thought it was fun. My brother always wanted me to play it, and I've been playing since sophomore year of high school. Favorite memory was playing in the Stang game 35-0 this year. It was really fun. Biggest life lesson I learned is that failure is one of your best friends, and it's the best lesson you can ever learn.
My name is TJ Pickering. I play O-line, D-line. I chose to play football freshman year, actually, because I got cut from the golf team. So I went to go play football, so I started freshman year. My favorite memory would definitely be playing football with all of us. Probably senior year opening game, Stang versus Stang, winning that game. When football is one of those games where you get knocked down all the time, so you just learn once you get knocked down, you have to get back up and keep going.
See if we can pick up exactly what happened to the Dartmouth quarterback, number 4, Will Kelly.
Ooh. Yeah, you can see that right leg hyperextended.
Doesn't look great. Unfortunate for that kid.
It's being escorted across the field right now in front of a very silent Dartmouth Stadium.
So he gets a big hand from the Dartmouth crowd. Fairhaven sideline stands are full. They're applauding the young man as well. Never like to see anyone injured, especially if you're a senior. Will Kelly, it's your last game as a high school athlete on the football field.
So it looks like they are going to have Chase Fenno play quarterback, who has played sparingly on JV as the quarterback, but he can throw it and he can run. So I don't know if the entire offense is put on a different level here, but he's an athlete and he can play. And his dad was a great athlete at high school as well. So
Chase Fenno.
Chase Fenno now at quarterback.
Right, the last thing he expected would be playing quarterback here in the opening quarter for the Indians on Turkey Day. Hands it to Dutra. Dutra skips over a man. He gets out across to the 35 to the 36-yard line.
So Fenno is a Fairhaven resident playing school choice for Dartmouth. So we have all Fairhaven quarterbacks now playing.
Yeah, it's not easy to keep track of all this, right?
So he's a school choice kid into Dartmouth, so. Little inside information there.
And Dutra with a nice run there. That was what they did the first play from scrimmage back in their first drive. So Dutra definitely a dangerous player on Dartmouth's offense.
And here's Marks. Marks blasting his way through out for a gain of 12 across the 45-yard line. First down, Indians.
New quarterback in the game, don't want to do too much. Go back to the stud. Marks has done it for 3 years now and just up the middle for a gain of 10 yards and Indian first down, moving the chains and almost at the end of the first quarter here. Good start by the Indians.
Here's Marks on the pitch, cuts it back inside. He's got running room. Marks in the secondary and he's out for a gain of 11 in another Dartmouth High School first down.
That was a nice adjustment by him there as he was running. Did you see that?
Absolutely, nice cutback. Doesn't matter who the quarterback is, and you got the offensive line putting a helmet on a helmet, making holes. You got Ethan Marks, you can make some progress down the field. Looks like Dartmouth's gonna take it to the second quarter here.
Time running out here, and they're gonna switch sides of the field. So, Paul, an interesting first quarter, but before we get to your comments, we're going to go to a senior spotlight.
My name is Patrick Crane, and I play middle linebacker. My favorite memory from high school is playing football since sophomore year. It was amazing coming out here as a sophomore and playing, and last year and this year has just been my favorite. The night before Thanksgiving, I actually have a game night with my entire family. And then on Thanksgiving Day, we have like a Olympic type thing in my aunt's backyard.
My name is Josh Miller and I play offensive and defensive line. I've been playing football for about 4 years now. I was big, so I decided to put my size to use. My plans after high school, I'm looking into going into BSU, playing football there. My favorite memory has to be playing football. I mean, just being out here with the guys, starting from first day of freshman year and being here with them still, it's great. One of the great life lessons is having good relationships with the people that are around you really help out in every kind of situation.
Second quarter about to begin here at Dartmouth Memorial Stadium alongside Jim Thompson and Andy Thompson. This is Paul Santos, a yard run, 1 yard run by Ethan Marks, his 11th of the year, got the Indians a 7-0 lead, and then a 27-yard field goal by Tyler Burke, made it 7-3.
Here's J.J. Estelin, and Estelin ekes his way just inside the Fairhaven 40-yard line. A lot of running there, Andrew, but not much of a gain.
No, a lot of running, and, you know, J.J.'s fast, but I like him getting upfield much better than him running sideline to sideline. He's a tough kid, runs hard, so you know, look for him to get upfield on those kind of plays rather than running sideline to sideline. Good play by the Fairhaven defense to string that out, though.
Second down and 8. Fenno in there at the quarterback spot. Will Kelly sitting on the bench being attended to. And here's J.J. going the opposite way this time. They string him out again. Cadence Chase this time shoves him across the 40 for no gain.
I think this is some of the, you know, I don't want to say issues, but when you're starting stud, you know, do everything quarterback goes out of the game, and you have a young sophomore quarterback playing for the first time in varsity, this is kind of some of the hiccups you might have. Keep it, you know, safe and give to the backs. Don't do anything too crazy here.
Yeah, the timing.
Yeah.
You wonder if they're going to run that quarterback option where Kelly is just fantastic at faking it to Marks and keeping it himself.
Correct.
So they go back to the workhorse, and Marks gets down to about the 46-yard line, but he's going to be about 4 yards short.
Well, this is a play where, you know, Kelly's great at. He can read the end so well that might have been a play he kept it and cut it to the outside and broke that for a big gain. So a little bit different. I think, you know, Fenno doesn't want to make a mistake. Give it to your guy. Get 6, 4th and 4, you know.
Surprised Ricky's going for it, Paul?
Well, yeah, it's a tough decision. 4th down and 5, you're not really, you're in that borderline spot of 4 down territory. And, you know, that last play, that exchange between Fenno and Estrelin, not the cleanest. So those are all factors the coach has to weigh, and he's being aggressive.
Here's Marks, and Marks isn't going to get it. Get him back to the line of scrimmage. And he slammed down there by Dante Biardi. Good play by the interior lineman. Fairhaven takes over on downs.
Nice play. I mean, the keys on defense for Fairhaven have changed now. You're going to key on Marks the whole time and let Chase Fennell make that read on his own. And as a young kid trying to make that read on a Thanksgiving Day game can be tough. And unfortunately, you see the crutches coming out down here on the Dartmouth sidelines for Will Kelly. So that is an unfortunate scene right there.
Well, certainly is. Outstanding career, Will Kelly, coming into this game with 17 rushing touchdowns and 6 via passing. And let's see if the Indians can hold on. Here's Joseph.
Oh,
he's going to throw it. He's got a man wide open down the center of the field, and he's got it. Indians are going to chase him and finally get him down at the 20-yard line.
He's not even
on the roster here.
Number 10, Tyler Burke.
Tyler Burke.
He was wide open from the jump. Again, Will Kelly's your safety. Come at him, you know, come out firing the first play here and take advantage of not having a senior in the back of their defensive field.
Check that, it was Tyler Burke on the catch.
Tell you that.
And that's got Fairhaven fired up.
Timeout Dartmouth. That was a play that I believe they were going to run, and the quarterback got flushed out of the pocket, and he rolled left, and he did have a man open in the end zone for that play, too. And so that was scary. I was looking out the corner of my eye, and I could see Isaiah Burleson, the senior wide receiver, got free in the end zone. And if it wasn't for the pass rush by Dartmouth that flushed him out of the pocket, that ball might have gone up in the air and into the end zone. So, wow, that's very, very impressive that they're able to put together a 40-yard pass play like that and execute it perfectly.
Yeah, and even on this last play, right down the seam wide open, no one looked at him, no one touched him, no one, you know, passed him off in the secondary, and just wide open. And when you're that wide open, you can just kind of throw it to any spot in the field and your guy can go get it. I mean, it makes a pitch and catch very easy in that situation.
And, Jim, going back to Coach White going for it on that fourth down situation, you know, back at that time he's making that decision, right? You know, the Dartmouth defense had done really well against Fairhaven. They held them in the end zone to a field goal. So he's thinking, okay, you know, what am I going to do, punt it down to the 10-yard line? If I don't get it, they still have it at the 40. That's a little ways to go. I'm sure he wasn't expecting this 40-yard bomb in the middle of the drive, so credit the Fairhaven Blue Devils for taking advantage of that good field position.
First and 10 Fairhaven.
First and 10 for the Blue Devils. Joseph at quarterback.
Chase in motion. They give it to the first guy through. That's Justin Marks. Marks gets it down to the 10-yard line. Solid run by Marks. Gain of 7.
Nice inside counterplay there, and you know, keeps the Dartmouth defense on their toes. You inside, then you break it outside, pop it real quick. I mean, that's kind of what they're known for, right?
Hurry up by Fairhaven.
Marks again over the left side, still on his feet, and down very close to the goal line. He'll spot him at the 1.
Down to the 1-yard line. It'll be first and goal for Fairhaven on the Dartmouth.
Another strong inside run by another Mark, so we'll see what happens here.
9-yard run to put him 1 yard away.
And they run it into the end zone on first and goal.
A little taste of Dartmouth's own medicine there. Inside run, inside run, inside run for a touchdown. Nice drive by Fairhaven to come out firing. 3 plays in a row, same play to number 25,
Marks.
Justin Marks, running hard.
Marks on the 1-yard carry for the touchdown.
So Ethan Marks getting into the end zone for the Dartmouth Indians. Justin Marks getting into the end zone for the Fairhaven Blue Devils.
And I got bad marks at Dartmouth High. Here's Burke, field goal maker early on in this one. Knocks this through, and suddenly Fairhaven has the lead with 8:46 to go in the opening half. They lead 10-7.
Well, I think we knew that quarterback Peter Joseph was able to put the ball in the air like that and really get some big yardage downfield, but I know it still felt like a surprise, you know. The Indians, you know, went for it on fourth, didn't get it. I kind of thought that, you know, Fairhaven might come down the field like they did before, running the ball, handing the ball off and all that kind of thing, and handing it over to your touchdown guy, Cadence Chase. But then all of a sudden that little play fake, and all of a sudden the ball's in the air and the receiver is 10 yards beyond the safety. And I'm like, oh, boy, that did seem to come out of nowhere.
Yeah, I mean, like I said earlier, the Fairhaven offensive formations and whatnot, they come out and anything is on the table this game. I think they just want to win. I think this is their Super Bowl every year. You know, always the last, 10 years have been underdogs big time. So they throw everything on the table and say, let's just go for it and, you know, try to, you know, make a play, and they do.
And a very good call by the offensive coordinator. They know Kelly is the glue of the entire team as a quarterback and as a secondary player.
Mm-hmm.
And right away, this challenge the secondary, which they did. And any good coach would do that.
Yeah, let's test out the deep field where Kelly has dominated defensively.
Right.
And exploit it.
And you can't blame the young fellow that's in their firm. They're just not as experienced as Kelly, who's a senior and a leader. And here's Marks. They string him out, and they just pull him right down, and that's going to be a penalty.
Yep. Got brought down by the back of his helmet. So that helps.
It most certainly does. Owen Burr, be called for the violation. You see the referees talking about it? Let's look on, Paul.
Well, let's see if we can zoom in here. Here comes Ethan Marks, who has 11 touchdowns on the season. He's being yanked down there by Kyle Figueredo on special teams of Fairhaven. And here is the call right here by referee Randy Braga. Face mask against Fairhaven. Big 15-yard penalty. And that moves the chain significantly. And look at the field position that the Indians have now. Down at the 47-yard line.
I want to wish everyone a happy Thanksgiving. You folks watching live via YouTube. I know there's a lot of Dartmouth residents watching in, especially a lot of you guys down in Florida, former coaches and whatnot, down there enjoying the warm sunshine. Beautiful day here in Dartmouth. Temperatures hovering around 50 degrees. Both sides of the stands are full. And Marks is out for a 5-yard gain.
Good start by Marks. Good start by the offense. Got to, you know, have a response here to Fairhaven's last drive. So got to regroup after the Kelly injury and get back in this game. I feel like the defense might have been a little deflated there after seeing Kelly go down.
Fenno turns, hands it to Marks. Marks twisting and turning his way down to the 45. He's going to be a couple yards short of the first down he was looking for. And I feel the defensive coordinator, Andrew, I just think you're going to key on Marks anyway, but you had to key on Kelly as well. Now you got 11 guys just keying on 34.
Yes, and that's can be good or it can be bad because Fenno was fast and he's an athlete. He can get to the outside. So if you want to keep pinching inside, 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 Fenno was fast enough to break to the outside or even make a pass. I've seen a couple of JV games where he can throw the ball 30, 40 yards down the field, no problem.
And Marks again, and he's got himself a first down as he pushed the pile down to the 40-yard line. Tyler Mahon credited with the Fairhaven tackle, but that's enough for Dartmouth first down, Paul.
Yeah, nice job there by Ethan Marks. And Andrew alluded to it, and you did too, Jim, about, you know, McKing on Ethan Marks. But, you know, as long as that offensive line continues to push off and has an opportunity for the Indians to get those runs, you know, Eli Johnson, you got Chase Lackey, Dan Martin, Josh Miller, all doing the job up front.
Oh, boy.
But that was not good.
Nope. Fairhaven has recovered the fumble. We'll look on.
It's been a problem for a couple games. High snaps, unfortunate bounce off Mark's helmet, I think.
It did. So, through the hands of the young quarterback and off the front of the helmet of Mark's, and Fairhaven has the first turnover of the ball game.
Chase Fenno really in a difficult spot, right? No matter how you look at it, he's only a sophomore. He's a great athlete. He works, you know, obviously as the backup quarterback, running back, outside linebacker, great athlete and everything. But still, the precision of handing the ball off, calling the plays, exchanges with your different running backs and so forth, not as polished, not as many reps. And so Fairhaven is thinking, well, they're going to exploit that.
And here's Joseph off the option fake, and he runs into Ethan Marks. He picked up just a couple.
Nice play by Chow here. Staying home, making the play go back inside to help the defenders on the pursuit there.
Yeah, well, offensively, right, a lot of players are going to have to step up, like Dutra, like Esterlin, in order to make the Indians an effective offense without Kelly.
Second down, 8. And here's Chase, and Chases scampers his way out there for a gain of three. Patrick Crane and Miller as well. They'll spot it just shy of midfield. Bring up third down and a long five.
Again, slow developing, counter play there. Dartmouth needs to stay home, needs to, just keep reading their keys. If someone blocks down, go down with them, fill the gaps, and get that pursuit back inside for Dartmouth. So let your Cranes and Marks come and make the tackle from the backside.
Yeah, Patrick Crane coming up from his inside linebacker position really read that one well and fired off well and just got his arms around the running back and limited his forward progress. And Fairhaven now with a third and five, and as Andrew pointed out, you never know what they're going to draw up. And you see on the Dartmouth sideline, Ricky White looking across as Fairhaven's coach Almeida calls a timeout. Very interesting game. I mean, it's looking like a chess match now. And now without Kelly in there, it just, it was going to be an interesting game anyway. And, of course, we feel bad for Kelly, and we hope he can get that knee fixed and get better soon. But it looks like he's not going to be back in this game, so it's too bad. That's a real tough break for him. But looking at this game, it makes this chess match even more interesting.
Well, no question about it. And when you put a young sophomore into what many think is the most exciting game of the season, and you lose senior leadership like that, I think Andrew made a good point defensively on that Fairhaven score. It's kind of like, geez, our leader is down and out, and they just were deflated, I think. But I think as this game goes on, I think the Indians will get it together.
Hopefully. I mean, you got young guys out there. I mean, Gomes is a junior. White is a junior. Fenno is a sophomore, I believe. So you got three guys back there playing defensively. That's your future. So, I mean, these guys need to play and step up. I mean, it's tough to see your stud go down and your leader, and, you feel good when he's back there with you, but, now it's your turn.
Joseph throws it here near side. Caught. Ooh. They said he had it, and he's going to be close to the first down. That's Cadence Chase. And it looks like he dropped the football. I don't think he had full possession. Let's look on.
Here we go. Bobble.
Never had it.
Here we go. I mean.
I'm just trying to figure out why they made the call that they did. Maybe the thought process was that he had it and then went out of bounds and then bobbled it, but the replay doesn't seem to match up with that.
No. And right in front of the Dartmouth bench, they were saying it right from the beginning, but.
Well, whatever was said doesn't change the situation. It's a first down. Chase will get credited for a reception. And they run it up the middle on first down. That's Justin Marks.
Fairhaven, of course, still has their senior quarterback in there, Peter Joseph, and they're surrounded by a lot of seniors like Isaiah Burleson, Cadence Chase, of course, with the record 19 touchdowns on the season. But offensively, they have a lot more options because you still have the senior quarterback in there. You're not limited to, well, we got to kind of go more conservative. You've seen them throw the ball downfield. They've thrown the little screen pass. So definitely every option is on the table for this Fairhaven offense.
Second and nine, Chase in motion. He's got it. He's got running room to the outside. Indians trying to string him out, and they do. They hold him to a gain of about three.
Very nice play there by Ethan Marks, stringing that out, not letting him get upfield, keep him run sideways instead of up and down, north to south.
So far, it's been Justin Marks, Andrew, doing the bulk of the ball carrying for Fairhaven and not Chase.
Yeah, kind of interesting. I was thinking that before, that the last drive, they kept giving it to Marks, and sooner or later, like I said, I think this Fairhaven offense, they want to pop one, and they're going to make your pinch inside, go inside, then quick to the outside. And it's a good game plan if it works for you.
Burke to the near side. Had a big reception early in this quarter. Here comes the rush. Joseph avoids it, still on his feet. He's going to step out of bounds just short of the first down marker.
So now it's Fairhaven's turn to play the
right
roll the dice game here.
This is what makes this quarterback so dangerous, right? Even on a broken play, look at this. He gets away from a very good pursuit by the Dartmouth Green. and still manages to get most of it. But here we go, fourth and four. They're going for it.
Watch the hard counts.
Dartmouth coaches with a little advice for the defense. I think they said, wake up. Were they talking to you, Paul?
Look at this. They're doing everything they can to get Dartmouth to go offside.
Here's Joseph on the pitch to Chase. Chase has got running room down the sideline. They're not going to catch him. Chase is going to go in for the score. Off the pitch, 44-yard touchdown.
Yikes. Well, I think everyone thought this was going to come to the strong side. Nice weak side call, kind of one-on-one out there on blockers and get Chase in the, you know, in the open field. He's just as good as Will Kelly, just as good as Ethan Marks we've seen all year, and he's a player for them and breaks it free. Nice run. Nice play call there to the weak side, not, you know, expecting that for a fear of the Dartmouth defense.
Fans across the way, happy as they can be. Tyler Burke in for the extra point. And the kick is up, and it's good. It's a Blue Devil 10-point lead as we go to a senior spotlight.
My name is Baron Dutra. I play wide receiver, outside linebacker, and running back. I didn't really choose to play football. My parents just kind of signed me up when I was young. I started playing when I was 5 and have played ever since. Favorite memory is probably all my sports memories, even though like sophomore and start of junior year were kind of tough with COVID, but it's still just been fun and it was a good time. It's really whenever you get knocked down, get back up. Happens every day in life, happens every day in sports. I love it. I live right across the street, so I've always walked over, came and watched the game. We know a bunch of guys from there. We used to play over in Fairhaven, so it's gonna be pretty fun.
My name is Ben Pino, and I play offensive line. I've been playing football since 7th grade, and a bunch of my friends convinced me to sign me up, and yeah, I just wanted to join in on the fun. Every single time we get to run out on the field on home games under the lights, it's always a special moment to me. I've been going to these games, the Dartmouth Fairhaven games, since I was a kid, so it's pretty cool to get to play on Thanksgiving, you know, and this one's gonna be my last game, so I just want to make this one as special as possible.
We're back here live at the stadium. The kick rolls into the end zone. Baron Dutra was back there and lost it in the sun.
Yeah, you can tell right off the bat he lost it. You couldn't see anything. And don't play many games during 10 o'clock during the year, so a little different view for him there. And unfortunately, as soon as the ball hits the end zone in high school football, it is an automatic touchback no matter what.
Well, we can understand why Laurie Lose was predicting a lot of scoring, right? You figure that 44-yard touchdown run on a fourth and four, pretty much in the middle of the field. So you had to make that decision. Okay, you're going to go for it on fourth down. We expected him to, both coaches being aggressive, but then to turn it into a touchdown.
Well, the Indians now trail by 10.
Ethan Marks, quarterback now.
Ethan Marks will turn and pitch it to J.J. Esterlin. And J.J. gets tackled and tackled hard for about a 2-yard gain.
Almost looked like a horse collar from our angle up here, but the referee was right there and didn't see anything.
It will be second and 7.
Well, the coaching staff looking to lean on the seniors. Put Ethan Marks back there, a quarterback, and that creates some interesting looks for the Indians because obviously, you know, Marks is going to run the ball much from the quarterback position like Will Kelly did.
Marks is going to keep it. Far side, diving to the 25. Just a short gain.
So watching some of the games this year, Ethan Marks is coming to throw Hail Marys instead of Will Kelly. So Marks can throw it. So it could be interesting to see, too, if they're going to give him the green light to actually throw the ball instead of just ground and pound. But he can air it out from what I've seen during the year.
Thing is the lack of reps, right? The lack
Absolutely,
of,
yeah.
You know, practicing, you know, Marks at quarterback. All the practice you did all week, preparing for Fairhaven. Got to start from scratch almost.
Well said. Marks going to throw it here on the inside. He's got to stand. It's caught. It's Dutra. And Dutra's going to be running out of bounds on the near sideline to the 40-yard line. Andrew Thompson with some good scouting there.
That's right. How about that for analysis?
No, insider information here. Nice tight spiral, nice catch to pass throw to Dutra.
Well, we talked about Dutra and Esterlin and a lot of the players on the offensive line, players like Dylan Gomes. These guys are going to have to deliver right now with the adjustments being made with senior quarterback Will Kelly injured for the day.
Here's Marks. Marks drilling his way out for a gain of 9. Solid run.
Nice run. And I'm a fan of Dartmouth coming out throwing with Marks early as well. Keeps the Fairhaven defense kind of on their toes, not keying on inside. Come out and throw a few, and now the defensive backs are saying, oh, crap, I can't, you know, just key on Marks and key on JJ. Got to watch the whole field.
Well, everybody's playing hard, but look at the run there by Ethan Marks. He's looking up at the scoreboard. He's seeing a 17-7 game. He gets that ball, and he just fired hard into that Fairhaven defense and picked up a couple of extra yards. Here we go.
Here's Marks. Here comes the rush. He throws over the middle. It's caught. Still running with the football is Dutra. And they're going to mark his forward progress at the 45-yard line in a late flag. You know, they cut Patrick Crane, I believe, for a personal foul.
I mean, unless they call it a crackback block, which is illegal, but if you get blocked and you know, cleanly, it's tough to throw a flag on that. And it came in late. The guy was on the ground.
It's too bad that happened because that was away from the play. It didn't really affect what was going on in the play. And it could end up hurting the Indians. Let's see what the referee, Randy Braga, you see there on the screen, is going to tell Rick White on the Dartmouth sideline over here. Going to stay with the call.
This reminds me, Andrew, kind of the Milton game. It's the same kind of feel to it. You know, the Indians with a turnover, ball goes up, marks his helmet, two personal fouls.
Yeah.
This has an odd feeling about it.
Yeah, I mean, it's just it's a wacky, you know, these referees always getting in each other's way. They always have to have, you know, pointing each other. And, you know, you got two guys pointing second down and,
Dartmouth coach is claiming it's first down. The down marker across the way is second down. They're claiming it should be first down because the incident happened after the game of play.
It was a first down on the play for the Indians, so I don't understand how it's second down.
Well, here's Marks. He's got his hands full the rest of this game. He gets his forward progress up across the 40. Where he's wrapped up there, Colby Career. Got his arms around Marks. 46 seconds remain in the opening half.
Dartmouth called a timeout right there. And here's Marks from the quarterback position. You could tell as soon as he started running that there was nowhere to go. There are just so many white shirts keying on him and following him to the far side of the field. You could tell that there was just no room to maneuver. So now we're down to 46 seconds left in the half, and it doesn't feel like the two-minute drill is going too well here.
Well, it's tough. I mean, you got Marks in there, and you get a first down play, then you get a personal foul that we didn't see, but now you're backed up. You got a backup quarterback. You have backup linemen in the game. Pickering's out. I mean, you got a lot of things against you when you need. You usually have three seniors that played all season long together. Now you got different moving parts. It's a lot to take on right now in the first half of the last game of the season.
Right, here it is, the marquee game of the year, not only in our area, but of course for both of these teams, right? This is the game that everyone is focusing on. And there you see Will Kelly on the sideline looking on. Again, tough break for him, tough break for the Dartmouth Indians.
Well, Indians send out four wide, empty backfield. Marks rolls near side. Here comes the rush, throws near side, complete.
Get up, fields.
Stepping out of bounds. Jalen, the Indian receiver.
Jalen Adams.
Yes.
Just a sophomore.
Absolutely.
Well, they got out of bounds, stopped the clock at 39 seconds, so that gives the Indians time to regroup. But how about Ethan Marks coming out? He's passing the ball almost every other snap. And it's definitely keeping that Fairhaven defense honest.
Here's Marks.
Still again.
Sets, throws, uh-oh, middle of the field. It's going to come up short, and it's going to be intercepted.
Cam Gordon for Fairhaven on the interception there.
Dutra was the intended receiver. That's too bad because, you know, I think they were thinking, hey, you know what, let's just go for the jugular here. But a little bit too much with 39 seconds to go when it happened.
And I'll tell you another thing that I've noticed in the second quarter. The Indian offensive line isn't playing a very solid game. I mean, Marks that time was under pressure. Every time he's gone back to pass, he's been under pressure.
Oh.
And this game is really being won at the line of scrimmage, and Fairhaven's winning that thus far.
Yeah, I mean, Fairhaven's done well on the both sides of the ball, actually. I mean, but Dartmouth is without T.J. Pickering this game, unfortunately. So that's one lineman down. And 75, Parker Souza, in the last defensive series, was out limping on the sideline. So that's two offensive and defensive linemen that are banged up.
Fairhaven is just going to take a knee, and that's going to do it. Here in the first half, the final 20 seconds will tick off without any action. 17-7 is our score. Your thoughts thus far, Andy? I'm
surprised at the Fairhaven's ability to get in the end zone and get long plays on the Dartmouth defense. Unfortunately, with the Kelly injury, you never know what's going to happen in the second half. Dartmouth's going to put something together at halftime and come up with a game plan.
I want to ask you, Andrew, 39 seconds left in the half, right? Obviously, the element of surprise is big. So by having him throw down like that, it was an element of surprise there. But it did feel like there was more time, that they could have maybe engineered something a little bit more deliberately there.
Yeah, I agree. I think, as a senior, trying to make a big play on the last game of your career and give somebody a chance. But I don't think he set his feet either. Like they were saying, the offensive line didn't give him a chance to throw. And if he set his feet, maybe he had a chance to lead it out there. But it's high school football, anything can happen.
All right, so our score at the half. Fairhaven High School 17, Dartmouth High 7. There will be a halftime show, the Dartmouth High School Marching Band, with a partial show, not their award-winning show. So stay tuned for that, and we'll see you back at the stadium in a few minutes. Thanks.
William Chow. I play fullback and outside linebacker. I chose football because it was a super fun and physical sport, and I've been playing for about 9 years. My favorite memory would have to be when I scored a touchdown against Stang. I think the rivalry game would be a great game because everybody's friends with each other that are playing, and we're just seeing familiar faces for the last time on the football field.
My name is Daniel Martin. My position is middle linebacker. I chose to play football when I was super young, 5. It was just, I watched football and I loved it. And I've been playing for about 12 years. My favorite memory is just coming out here and playing with all my friends, just having fun, playing with my boys. The rivalry game with Fairhaven, it's a big game. I love it. I mean, it's both teams going at it, and they know it's just for fun. But both teams just like to hit and have fun.
I just saw them selling them over there. I don't think it would go good if I brought it home.
Show each year, we come up with an idea that's basically a team of people that put it together. This year's idea happened to be my personal idea for the show, with the idea of the thorns and the petals. And then we have a design team that works together, about 6 or 7 people, to actually put the show together, whether that's writing the music or writing the visual package, and then all the choreography that goes along with the show.
The drumline and the instrumental musicians, we were the thorns, and the color guard brought the petals aspect to the show, which brought the beauty and the opposite side of the thorns.
The MetLife experience is something special. It was actually weird because it had been a couple years since we'd done that, and going to MetLife, as soon as you walk in, it's a whole new venue with like all the lights and giant professional stadium. It's nothing like anything else we do the whole season. So that's something special that we look forward to every year.
Walking into MetLife is, you know, you go through the tunnel and you have lights on you, you have a large crowd. It's definitely very different to other venues that we've performed at. We usually just perform at regular high school stadiums. I don't know how to describe it. It was just an overwhelming joy for me personally. I love performing and I love putting on a great show.
It's a really cool feeling to be a part of something that's much greater than you. The trophies will always be in the hallway, even when I'm not in the hallways, so it's something to be proud of for sure.
It's just a testament of our hard work and paying off in the end. I think we really owe that all to our directors and the staff and parent volunteers that we have. We're very fortunate in Dartmouth to have such a great staff and parent volunteers, and like, we would not be as strong as we are without them.
There's a real legacy here at Dartmouth with the marching band program. I'm lucky that I took over this program 2 years ago, but it goes way back into the 80s. And there's something special about that, with a community that supported this throughout all those years. So, you know, there's a little bit of pressure with that, but at the same time, I know that I have all that community support behind me to make this happen.
Yeah!
ladies and gentlemen, the Dartmouth High School Indian Marching Band.
My name is JJ Esselin. I play running back and cornerback. I played football since I got to Dartmouth. I played in fifth grade, but it didn't go too well. So then I just ended up working for it, and I started playing at Dartmouth. I chose to play it because it just looked like really fun, the brotherhood and all that. I just wanted to be a part of it. A lot of lessons that I learned playing football is if you work hard, great things will always come no matter what. I've never been part of a rivalry since I've never been to Dartmouth before, so I never like had that. So having that feels really great. It feels really good to be a part of. Just want to go out there and get a win.
My name is Ethan Marks, and I play running back and safety. I choose to play football because the bonds it makes. And I grew up watching my brother playing, and he won the back-to-back Super Bowls. And that really like made me want to play for high school. And I've been playing since fourth grade. A good lesson I learned was from Coach Martin. He always says that the easiest thing is to quit. So every time I'm doing like a math problem or doing anything on the football field, that's what clicks in, and I just keep going. My thoughts on the rivalry is, I don't think there's anything around here as special as that. Other teams, other schools, I think this is the most important game to everyone this season. We got a lot of friends on the other team, so I think this will be special.
Back out here at the stadium, our score at the half is Fairhaven High School 17, Dartmouth High School 7. I'm Jim Thompson alongside Andy Thompson and Paul Santos. Happy Thanksgiving to one and all. I understand we have a pretty big YouTube following, which is great. And, of course, you people on Channel 9, happy Thanksgiving to all you town folk. First half, Paul Santos.
Yeah, the beginning of the game, the Indians came out like a house of fire on offense. A great special teams return got them great field position. And then just over a minute, 9:22 to go in the first quarter, Indians came downfield, and they capped it with a two-yard touchdown run by touchdown maker Ethan Marks, his 11th of the year. Tara Dash extra point made it 7-0, the Indians, and they were off and running. But then Fairhaven came back with 2:33 to go in the quarter, a 27-yard field goal by Tyler Burke. Still a good job by the Indian defense to keep Fairhaven off the board in terms of a touchdown in the red zone. So things were still looking pretty good. But then Fairhaven got the ball back after a Dartmouth fumble. There was a 40-yard pass to Tyler Burke right down the middle that eventually set up a 1-yard touchdown run by Justin Marks. And it was a 10-7 lead. And then, of course, the injury to quarterback Will Kelly really hurt the Indians both offensively and defensively. Obviously, offensively, the quarterback, defensively, in the defensive backfield. And that was exploited by Fairhaven. It was a 44-yard touchdown run on fourth down by Cadence Chase. And the extra point kicked by Tyler Burke. And that's where we are now, 17-7 in favor of Fairhaven. A couple of other notable events, not only the Kelly injury, but a couple of turnovers, a fumble by the Dartmouth Indian offense, which happened when Kelly was still in there. And then at the end, the interception, as the Indians pretty much went for a surprise Hail Mary with about 39 seconds left, and the ball was intercepted. The Indians also penalized a little bit in that half, and that also hurt them. But, during the break, the three of us have been talking, what are the Indians going to do? What is Ricky White going to draw up to stay in this game with their main guy, the quarterback, Will Kelly, out for the second half? It's hard to come up with a plan that we think would be really something that could give them a win here, trailing by this much.
Andrew, any thoughts on the second half? You're Coach White. You stick with number 34 at the quarterback spot, or do you put back the sophomore?
That's a really good question. If you're Coach White, I think
that's why I'm your father.
I think you got to get Ethan Marks back in the running back position. Let him see the field better than being the the first option guy. I think he's better off coming off a fake and getting the running start from the backfield. There's different options. You know, you have, I believe there's Nico, who's played JV quarterback, who can throw the ball. Nico Morris, who's a sophomore quarterback. You also have Sean Martin, who's a backup quarterback, who can throw the ball. So you have a couple different options to go through in the second half. It just depends on who they want to go and what direction they want to go. So we'll see what happens in the second half. But, you know, you do have good senior leadership from this Dartmouth backfield. So hopefully something pans out for them going forward.
Well, looking down on the sideline, Ethan Marks has the football, and he's throwing it to Baron Dutra warming up. So looks like Marks may get the start here in the second half. Our score here from the stadium is Fairhaven 17, Dartmouth High School 7. And Paul, you had mentioned the Indians went down and scored in about a minute and a half on the opening drive. And then after that, they haven't done much. Of course, the injury to Kelly didn't help much.
Right. You know, one of the things I was noticing too, and Andrew pointed it out, that, you know, Marks can throw the ball. So he had a couple of completions, a couple times for first down. He had the little screen pass to the outside, the little out pass for about 7-8 yards. He had a couple down the middle that were successful, obviously the interception. But, you know, that's something that maybe that's something they can do as we look at Will Kelly. Oh, he's got to be thinking to himself, oh, just let me go out there. Please, you know, imagine sitting on the sideline and standing on the sideline that like that, knowing that you're out on Thanksgiving and just dying to go out there and help out your teammates. It's got to be just brutal. But there he is, and seems to be in good spirits, and he's supporting his teammates. And we'll have to see what they can do. But Mark's throwing the ball. Do you think that they can do that effectively on a consistent basis?
I think you got to stick with the rollouts. If you're going to do that, stick with the rollouts. Give them the option to run the ball if nothing's there. And like we talked about earlier, too, the offensive line, some of the passing plays that he ran looked like the offensive line had some holes and rushed the throw. So maybe get him on the move and make, you know, they're used to that. That's their offense, so hopefully they can get that going.
So the Indians will kick off to start the second half. They trailed by 10. Caden Chase back deep to receive. And he looks up into the sun and will take it from his own 10. And still on his feet as he gets it across the 25 and out to the 30-yard line, where Fairhaven will have the first possession of the second half with the lead by 10 points. I'm Jim Thompson alongside Paul Santos, Andrew Thompson. From all the folks here at Dartmouth Community Media, happy Thanksgiving to one and all in the great town of Dartmouth in this great tradition, 10 a.m. every Thanksgiving morn. Free coffee and donuts, pretty good, Paul.
Yeah, I saw that. Come right in, you get some hot chocolate, coffee and donuts. I was not going to have a donut because I knew that I was going to have a big Thanksgiving dinner, but I caved in and I saw the sugar donut. That was it.
And they come out and run it on first down. Justin Marks across the 40, out to the 41. Gain of 6 on the play.
And we talk about defensive stands, right? If there's ever a time that Dartmouth's defense needs to step it up, it's right now on this drive and throughout this second half to get back in the game.
Absolutely.
And Marks pulls his way out for a first down out to the 45-yard line.
I think everybody was so worried about Caden Chase running the ball that Justin Marks has had a pretty good game for himself running up the middle. They're exposing this Dartmouth offensive defensive line and, you know, giving Dartmouth a taste of their own medicine, getting 5 to 6 yards a whack here on every run.
And unfortunately, we have a young man down for Fairhaven.
One of the things from the Dartmouth point of view, right, trying to stop this Fairhaven offense, it's multifaceted. They can do so many different things. They can draw up so much. And if you can't stop the inside run, right, Fairhaven doesn't really have to go to much else to keep control of this game as that young man gets up slowly.
That's Justin Marks for Fairhaven, so.
He'll be escorted by the Fairhaven trainer.
You know, he's only a freshman, right? And he doesn't look like a freshman. He plays like an upperclassman. He's got 4 touchdowns on the season, and he's carried the ball quite a bit for the Fairhaven Blue Devils. In fact, he has a touchdown today, so he has 5 touchdowns now in the season for the Blue Devils.
First and 10, Fairhaven. And they pitch it to the far side of the field, and yet another first down, a gain of 15. That time, Colby Correa, the ball carrier.
It's one-on-one on the outside. The hat on the hat. It's one-on-one on the outside. And nice block by Correa and get up the field. Nice first down by Fairhaven. And if you're Fairhaven, this is what you want. Open the drive. Open this game. Put it away.
And in the first quarter when they did that, Will Kelly was on that side of the field. And that makes a big difference.
You see second-year head coach for the Fairhaven Blue Devils, Coach Almeida, looking to end the losing streak as Dartmouth has won eight straight Thanksgiving Day games.
And this is the quarterback, Peter Joseph, doing a nice job at the helm this morning for the Blue Devils. Maybe picked up a yard. We'll call it second down and nine. Just over 10.5 to play here in the third. This is a good look at Coach Almeida with his quarterback. He's got to be happy, Andrew, with what he's seen here this morning.
Absolutely. I mean, for, you know, is it his first year, Coach? I think it's his first year at the helm, second year at the helm. You know, it's a big game for him and big game for the school. So hopefully, if you're a Fairhaven fan, they pull it out and upset Dartmouth today.
And flags come down. It's a false start against Fairhaven. And I had a funny feeling there, Andrew, on that play here that Cam Gordon was going to throw this.
He's a backup quarterback for Fairhaven, so it wouldn't surprise me. And, you know, like I said before, anything is possible with this Fairhaven program. We've seen it all, so everything's on the table for them today.
Well, if he's going to throw it, it wasn't really anything basic. You know, sometimes you see a flea flicker or a halfback option. There was all kind of crisscrossing going on. And then the next thing you know, here comes, you know, this Fairhaven player rolling to his right, kind of without anybody around him. And if he was going to throw it, he had plenty of time to do it.
Second and 14. We have a new ball carrier in there. That's Tyler Mahon. Peter Crane said hello. Happy Thanksgiving.
Number 54, kind of an interesting player there.
Almost sounded like Mahomes when you said it quickly. This is what we need from the Dartmouth point of view. Third down and four. I mean, really, we talk about four down territory. Everything's four down territory once you get to the 50-yard line, right? So you're going to need two stops here on these next two plays from scrimmage.
Third and an Uber ride. Here's Joseph. Rush throws out in the flat, caught, and taken down immediately. Pass was completed to Justin Marks back in the game.
Good pass rush there by the Indians. Rushes the throw for Joseph a little bit, but
takes a chunk.
In there chasing.
Takes a chunk off of that third and 14, so now fourth and eight. So here is where the Dartmouth Indian defense, this is a must stop. I don't think there's any question about it. Clock rolling, 8:33 to go. It's still third quarter, still plenty of time, but you're down 17-7. You have the injury to Kelly.
As an old ball coach, I was just saying to myself, you got the 10-point lead, backup quarterback for the Indians, pin them back inside their 15-yard line and make them drive the field.
And that's what they're doing.
So flags fly here. Delay a game against Fairhaven, they'll take it.
I tell you, even on a fourth and eight, you have to be thinking, are they going to go for that? That would be pretty gutsy, but you're absolutely right. Pin him deep. The Indians' offense has been challenged with Kelly not in there. Make him go the length of the field.
Good snap, high kick. Marks got room. Miss 15. Marks got room here on the near side. If he gets a block, he gets it. Marks is down the sideline. He's got one man to beat. And he's going to just step out of bounds inside the 5-yard line.
Marks picked up a huge block from somebody initially coming towards the sideline. We'll have to take a look here. Sprung him. Can't see who that was. So J.J. Esselin maybe had a huge block. It was a low punt. And gave Marks plenty of return room to get that going down. Looks like he steps out on the 6 or 7 yard line.
That's an 85-yard return there. by Ethan Marks, who takes the game into his own hands on special teams and puts the Indians on the doorstep of getting right back in this game.
Ball, Mark, just inside the 10 is Esterlin. Esterlin cracks it down to about the 4-yard line. Huge, it'll bring up second and goal.
Huge momentum swing for Dartmouth here. This reminds me of a couple years ago when Fairhaven went for two, and it changed the whole momentum of that game, and Fairhaven was kind of in control of that game. Big play sprung for Dartmouth, so hopefully Dartmouth can punch one in and get that momentum back on the Indian side here.
Ethan Marks in there at the quarterback spot. Esterlin, the lone runner behind him. Here's Esterlin, and he just gets back to the line of scrimmage, perhaps a gain of one. Nolan Arruda, the tackler. Third and goal from the 4.
They're going to find a way to get in the end zone here, Andy, because, you know, that nice 80-plus yard return. 10 yards down, your quarterback out. It's a must touchdown.
Yeah, I mean, it's a big, you know, between a 7-point game and a 3-point game in a situation like this, I'll take the 3.
Here's Marks rolling right. Here comes the rush. He avoids it.
Throw it.
Marks down close to the goal line. They're going to mark him at the 1-yard line. So they rolled Marks out to the far side. Secondary covered well, and Ethan gets it down just inside the 2. It'll be fourth down.
Not the ideal situation if you're Ethan Marks, but that's when you miss Will Kelly. You know, he had Dutra moving in the end zone. Marks is a runner. He's not a thrower, so he's looking to run first, where Kelly might have seen Dutra open in the end zone for that touchdown. But regardless of the way, he got it down to the 2, and here we go.
Going to give Marks a lot of credit there because he came so close to being sacked, which would have been a disaster. Now he's back down to the 2. Here we go. Fourth and goal at the 2.
Esterlin and Crane behind Marks. High snap. Esterlin, left side. He's not going to get there. The Indians can't get it in. They turn it over on downs.
That's close.
He does not get in.
Let's look on.
Nope. Good call by the refs there.
And that, as Paul said, that's a heartbreaker for the Indians if you're a fan of the team, for sure.
Now, at that point in time, right, could you have kicked the field goal there, made it a 7-point game? Well, I don't know. Not the way the Fairhaven offense has been running the ball. So maybe the thought process was, is look, we got the ball inside the 10. It's touchdown or nothing. Because a field goal there would have been relatively easy, I would think, with Taradash. Could have got it to 7. But, you know, those are decisions you have to make. But I like the decision going for 7 there.
Yeah, I agree. Got to be aggressive. You got to try to score in this situation and make them go 99 yards on you.
Second down and 9. Joseph, first down run of a couple. You can feel the air has been taken right out of the stadium.
Yeah, I mean, they could have had a one-possession situation, a one-possession game here. But let's see if they can pin him and get the ball back in midfield.
He run it over the left side for a short gain. That's Justin Marks back in the game after a brief injury.
Yeah, I don't think Fahim's going to do anything crazy right now. Backed up way back in their own territory, just trying to get it out.
I think they've figured out that Dartmouth is going to have a hard time to score. Basically changing their offense. Different players in different positions. It's an uphill battle for the offense for sure.
Getting late in the third quarter too now, down to 4:34 and counting.
So they hand it off to Marks once again, and he's very close to that first down he was looking for.
I think it's all. Did they give it to him?
He's gone. It is a first down. That's a backbreaker as well.
Yeah, just more time off the clock as well. And, you know, it's demoralizing. If you're on the defense side, you want to get the ball back for your offense and score. And
an 80-yard return on that kickoff, they don't happen all the time. So having that happen, having Marks delivering that run, getting the block and all that, setting the table for that score, needed to capitalize on that.
So we have procedure called against Fairhaven. They just seem extremely confident. They've had a good season, 7-3. Came into this game with a lot of confidence, and I'm sure once Kelly went out, it's made a major difference, both offensively and defensively, Paul, for Dartmouth High School.
Well, I like their offense because you come in here thinking, okay, you got the quarterback, you got the running back, Cadence Chase, now with 20 touchdowns on the season. But there's a lot of other things they can do. I mean, he can throw that ball very well, Peter Joseph can. We saw him do it a couple of times already. So, and they can go to the outside, and they go to the inside. Multifaceted offense, tough to stop. Now we talk about an important series, right, Jim and Andy? Another chance here for the Indians to stop them. Still plenty of time.
Yeah, I mean, I think Fairhaven's going to be very conservative here right now, too. You know, they don't want to put it up in the air where a deflected ball or batted ball gets dumped right back in it. So just keep doing what you're doing and, you know, run the counters and run inside, you know, the traps. And you don't see a lot of options right now down this side of the field for Fairhaven.
Second down, 14 now for the Blue Devils. Holding on to a 10-point lead on the road here in Dartmouth. And there's a pitch to the wide side of the field. That's Korea, the ball carrier. And Korea's out for a gain of 12 and close to the first down he was looking for.
Not sure who that wide receiver is over there or on the Fairhaven side, but he is blocking extremely well this game and not letting the defensive backs of Dartmouth get off the blocks and make a tackle early in the play.
That pitch out to the wide side of the field has been effective all day long.
Yeah, and it's good block on the outside. You know, you close off the end and you get that gap and you get the wide receiver getting blocked downfield. I mean, 6, 7, 8 yards before anyone's even touched on the field that way. So it's a good, smart play there.
And from the Fairhaven point of view, it's all you need to do is that and the inside runs and you'll end up in the win column.
Absolutely.
Maybe an occasional surprise pass going for the jugular, but other than that, and we have a timeout on the field.
Man, Coach Almeida, believe he was complaining about the stadium clock. And he's having a nice, so what do you think they're talking about? What are you having Thanksgiving? The guy with the white hat. You know, he's asking me, you want to come over for pie after if we win this game? So, Paul, what are you doing for Thanksgiving?
Well, actually, we're driving into the big city right after
New
this
Bedford?
Game is over. No, not that big city, even bigger city than that. Now, my son Dylan, who does or has done hockey games with me over the years, my other son Andrew has been doing them too. Well, we're going to be driving up to Boston to spend the day with my son Dylan and his very recent bride, my new daughter-in-law, Stephanie. And we're going to hang out, have a little turkey, have a little stuffing, have a little drink, kick back, watch a little football, and just have a nice afternoon. And then tomorrow, we're going to meet up with my other son. You know, this doesn't have to be like squeeze it all in one day, you know. We'll see one son today, then tomorrow, you know, we'll see the other son. We'll meet up with my other son, Andrew. And Andrew and I are looking forward to Big Dartmouth Sting hockey game in a couple of weeks, which always fills up the arena with 1,000 people. So we're looking forward to that one. And that's it. So that's what we're doing. How about you? You got a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah, we do. I think my wife is out of jail. Andrew's a probation officer. I think he made a call. Once again, caught at Buttonwood Park, coaxing a pigeon. Mm-hmm. You know, she went to the place on Cove Road there and the old farm store, and there she was. And
you had to make some
night,
calls.
Last night, I opened the oven up, and there's the poor thing there, knows that it's cookies in a few hours. And, once again, it's become a tradition, a Buttonwood Park pigeon.
Well, there's a sign that says don't feed the pigeons.
There
it doesn't
is.
Say anything
That's
else.
That's why Andrew had to make the call as the probation officer.
Third there's no sign that says anything else.
No right. sign says anything else. Third and very short here, and Joseph will try to plow his way forward. And the referee on the far side has it marked as a first down.
First down, Fairhaven.
Wow.
Generous spot.
It most certainly was. Ball is on the 20. But as Andrew said earlier, they started this drive from their own 1 yard line. They're just chewing up the clock. Pick up a couple of first downs. The Indians can't get hold of the football as they run it to the far side. And a great job there on Colby Correa.
Nice play by Chow. So you got to shed the block and get upfield and prevent that guy from getting upfield. So that's what the Indians have been missing on that side of the field so far in this drive. So good play. Be aggressive by Chow. Be in position, though, to make the play.
Now, that could be big because you haven't seen too many losses. You've seen gains of three, you know, gains of four. Sometimes you say, okay, that's pretty good, but a loss of two.
Am I correct that the Indians have only had one possession in this third quarter?
I believe you're right.
Here's Joseph. He's going to throw it down the middle of the field. Indians back there. And
flag on the play. A lot of contact.
Oh, my God.
Oh, that was definitely incidental.
Yeah, that
way before the ball, you know.
The ball was nowhere near catchable.
And players were just running down the field.
We'll take a look at this.
No way it was catchable.
It's 10 yards over the guy's head. Three Dartmouth Indians are there, and this guy's going to chuck a flag.
The Fairhaven wide receiver got tangled up as he was running down the field. I mean, you know, you don't have to get out of the way. You just have to not interfere with him. If the Fairhaven player runs into you, what can you really do about it? Let's try to look at this again because it happened way before the ball got there.
Well, that's ridiculous.
What a, I mean, this guy just, I mean, I don't know. You can hear the Dartmouth coaches upset. Probably never played anything athletic in their life and throwing the flags at most they can do.
First and 10 for Haven. They're in control of this ball game, no question about it. And this guy's been a workhorse all day, Justin Marks. Hadn't heard much about him. We heard about Chase with his 19 touchdowns, school record over at Fairhaven, Paul. And we haven't seen much of him other than a beautiful long touchdown that he had down the far sideline. But this kid, Marks, been the workhorse.
Yeah, absolutely. Marks for them and Marks for us. But, yeah, Marks for Fairhaven. He has been a workhorse. He's got into the end zone, scored a big touchdown for Fairhaven. But this series right here, you know, you look at that Will Chow tackle, throwing him for a two-yard loss. That's all wasted by this flag. It's unfortunate.
Here's the pitch. Here's Chase. Chase stiff arms the man.
Mask.
And shoves his hand into the face mask of the Dartmouth defender, and no flag.
Yeah. Here we go. So you can't grab the defender's face mask. So right here you can clearly see, right.
Right, you can stiff arm him, but you can't grab the face mask. So. I mean, you can see the neck snap back.
That was J.J. Esterlin, who caught a fistful of Chase's hand. And Marks picks up the first down.
So you're going back. If that pass had been ruled incomplete, there's a good chance the Indians would have gotten the ball back. Right, so now you got the ball back late in the third quarter, down by two scores. Now you still got a chance in this game, but Fairhaven just continues to grind down the field, and we get deep into the fourth quarter. You know, it's a two-possession game. Makes it really tough.
So they've marked the football 46 yards and have eaten up the entire third quarter. One possession for Dartmouth. 17-7 at the end of three. Let's go to a commercial.
I love you, baby, if it's right up.
Life, pain, and tights.
Yeah.
I've got you deep in the heart of me.
How wonderful life is.
Move your butt, I'll sing it again.
Never gonna make you cry. Say goodbye, yeah. Tell a lie. Trust in me when I say.
Oh no! Oh no! Oh, that was sneaky.
Yeah, I think I'm taking the headsets off. And
that was sneaky. Yeah. Oh, man. Oh, boy, I didn't expect that.
That is Paul Santos Live, and that show should be called Paul Santos Deceased.
Well, I said I was going to have you zoom in. And what was your response?
I'm zooming out.
Yeah, zooming
immediately.
Out. Zooming out.
Catch that on Facebook. It's a great show. It's a version of the old Johnny Carson show. A lot of local talent. Except when he invited me. That was just local, no talent. First and 10 for Haven. 12 minutes to go in this one. Here's Chase. He's got room along the far sideline, still on his feet, and kind of trips himself up, but not before he picked up a gain of 9.
Just want to say something real quick before we get into this play. It looks like potential injury there. Jim, you fit right in. You jumped right in, and you started singing, and you started doing comedy, and you fit right in. You fit like a glove.
Well, my wife and Andrew, Andrew was texting during the show, and he wasn't very complimentary towards his father, especially when I got a text from someone that said, "Nice job, Daddy," and I didn't recognize the number. That led to a little problem at home. Of course, married to an attorney.
Yeah.
As Chase limped off the field, and we have a Dartmouth High School Indian.
That looks like Crane.
Yeah, you hate to see this, you know. We're talking about the turf, you know. Obviously, the turf is superior to the grass in terms of care and, you know, the way it is. It doesn't get all messed up when you have rain and mud and all that. But there is a downside to it. Even that Kelly injury, we were talking that perhaps the way his knee got stuck on the turf and there isn't that give. And sometimes that can potentially work the other way. We hope not. And we hope that this, you know, doesn't turn out to be a situation where there's more injuries than we had before because, you know, this is great having this turf. Crane gets up now.
And Chase is just getting up from the Fairhaven sideline and he's trying to run it off. Could see him there down on the left side. Now he's running back toward the bench.
Yeah, Chase looked like he had a cramp from what I saw.
This turf is definitely superior to the turf that they used to have, you know, the old AstroTurf they used to have in Pittsburgh and they used to have it out in Cincinnati. I mean, it was like playing on concrete. This stuff has that rubber and it has some give, but, you know, perhaps on grass and mud, you know, maybe you have just a little bit more give.
Second down and short now here for Peter Joseph in the Fairhaven offense. They hand it off to the workhorse. Marks out for a gain of 6. Two things on that one, Paul. A first down and keeping the possession and running the clock out.
Yeah, that clock is becoming a huge enemy. You know, I'm thinking back now, and I agreed with the call at the time, but, you know, you kick that field goal, it's a one-possession game. Fairhaven probably would be a little bit more aggressive. I don't know. Maybe they'd still be conservative. But the fact that you went down there and came up with no points at all and the game is still a two-possession game, well, that plays right into, you know, what Fairhaven's trying to do right here. Just run it outside, inside, first down, move the chains. It doesn't matter how long it's taking.
And this drive started at their own 2-yard line.
And it was a long time ago.
And absolutely. They're very content to do what they just did there. Put it in the belly of Marks. Pick up one or two. Just under 11 minutes to play in the ball game. I'm Jim Thompson alongside Paul Santos, Andy Thompson as well. Once again, happy Thanksgiving to everyone in the town. And you former alumni on both sides of the ball, we welcome you on YouTube as the Indians commit the offside penalty. That was Josh Miller.
More penalties on Dartmouth than Fairhaven in this game, which has hurt the Indians' cause. And, of course, the injury to quarterback, defensive back Will Kelly, we've mentioned that a number of times, has hurt them. Also, you know, Fairhaven hasn't put the ball on the ground. They haven't turned the ball over at all in the whole game. You know, you always hear coaches starting with the GOAT there, Bill Belichick. He'll just say over and over, turnovers, right, penalties. Don't make mistakes. Do your job, right? Well, Fairhaven not fumbling, not turning the ball over like, you know, Fairhaven. Rather, Dartmouth could have really capitalized if they could have gotten a turnover from Fairhaven.
Marks again plowing forward. And looks like he's going to have himself yet another first down.
Right down by Josh Miller and Dan Martin.
This is just a killer drive
right now. Yeah, this feels like the old wishbone days.
Yeah.
We're going to bring the sticks out.
And the thing you worry about if you're Dartmouth is Cadence Chase has the ability to break it. Mm-hmm. They've just pounded you up the middle. One of these times they're just going to flip it out to him and someone's going to fall asleep out there on the edge, and he can break it. We saw it early in this game. It's one of those lull you to sleep, and then you know he's going to hit you quick, and
right.
That could be it for the Indians.
Mm-hmm. Here's the measurement. Let's see. It's close. Oh, first down. Well, it looks like Randy Braga, the referee in the white hat, he really had to take a close look.
First down for Fairhaven.
I think if you're the Indian defense right now, you're exhausted. And I had mentioned earlier in the game, Andrew, that this is one of the few games that the Dartmouth offensive defensive fronts have lost the battle on the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, I mean, before the game, we looked at the Fairhaven. We said, wow, this is a big team for them, and not only numbers-wise, but, you know, size-wise, you know, physical size. So, you know, the years before, Dartmouth could just pound them and run them over and, you know, get in those holes and stop these, you know, pitch plays. But this year, they're built differently, and they're showing it.
First and 10 for Haven. They've had the ball, other than one possession to Dartmouth, the entire second half is Marks. Blasts his way forward.
Marks again on the carry.
I mean, Paul, he's picking up 3, 4, 5 yards every time he touches it.
That's all you need at this point in the game. Two possession game, just get you 2, 3, 4 yards. This drive started back at the 2-yard line, as you said, just coming right down the field, eat up the whole rest of the third quarter. Already down to 9 minutes to go here in the ball game. And, of course, any kind of points here from Fairhaven will finish the game off.
Here's Joseph, the quarterback. He keeps it. It's going to come up about a yard short of the sticks.
If you're Fairhaven, this is perfect for you. You got third and two, third and one. Run it twice. I mean, Marks is getting 2-3 yards on a pop. Like,
it's all you need.
No, why would you do anything different at this point? Just killing the clock and just demoralizing the defense.
You're talking about the lack of turnovers, right? I mean, a turnover here is the only chance really Dartmouth has.
Marks on the carry.
And this is Marks. Gain of 3. More importantly, first down. Just chewing up this clock. The Indians have had one touch in the second half. That's it.
You can't come back and win the game if you don't have the ball. And you need to have it twice.
Right, and this Fairhaven offense, you can't send the house against this. You can't do anything because if you miss, you're gone. All they got to do is flip it to the outside. And, you know, someone's not where they're supposed to be. And it's a tricky offense to defend when it comes to different formations and different plays.
Joseph on the perimeter, looking for room and gets smacked out of bounds along the far sideline. Ethan Marks was the tackler, but Paul, another solid gain of 7.
Yeah, and that's what they're doing there. Their game plan here is different than it might have been. You know, we think back of Ethan Marks. You just mentioned him making that tackle when he had that 80-plus yard kickoff return down to the Fairhaven 10. And the Indians got in there. Let's say the Indians had scored there. Fairhaven may not be doing this conservative thing, you
right.
know. And now maybe they throw the ball. Maybe you get a pickoff or something.
Well, here they run it. They're going to go in for a touchdown. That's Colby Correa. And that may do it. With 6:53 to go, they up the lead to 23-7. Andrew, bang it inside, bang it inside, bang it inside. Pitch it outside for the touchdown.
That's what I was thinking the whole time. Just sooner or later, someone's going to fall asleep, and there's going to be a gap or a hole. You wear this Dartmouth defense down the whole way down the field, 99 yards for a touchdown. I mean, I don't remember the last time I've seen a high school offense just play after play after play. I don't know how many plays that was. Paul will know, but you know, it's a demoralizing drive to go 99 yards on you from and no big hitters, just, you know, paper cuts all the way down the field.
Right, and again, you know, had the Indians been able to capitalize right after that long return to the Fairhaven 10, say they got in there, got a score, now it's a three-point game. You know, Fairhaven may not be coming down the way they did just then. They may have been forced to be more aggressive. So the fact that it was a two-score game really made it a lot easier for the Fairhaven offense in terms of their strategy.
Yeah, it's old-school football, but old-school football is very fundamental, and that was a fundamental drive. Do what you're good at. You know we're going to run it here, try to stop us. And unfortunately, the offensive line for Fairhaven is good. they are just, you know, putting hats on hats and getting the holes. And you got Justin Marks, a freshman, just falling forward for 3, 4, 5 yards of whack. I mean, there's nothing more you can do.
And if you're Derek Almeida, you're looking at this kid for the next 3 years, Marks. Not bad. If you look to build your program. Esterlin.
This is Dutra.
This is Dutra. They were fighting for the ball, and Dutra's just going to be slammed down. Nice special teams play by Isaiah Burleson. And nothing really has gone right for the Indians since the injury to their quarterback. It's just been a tough road to drive. It's just, it's been rough.
Well, we kind of talked about the half when high school football has changed. You can't have the 3-hour practices like you had back in the day. So backups don't get the time they used to have. So when you're do everything quarterback goes out, the backups don't get the playing time in practice. They're usually on the red team or scout team. So, you know, the whole thing changes. And, you know, when you're a kid, you say, oh, no, you know, man, my best friend, the best player we have, and now he's out. And it's just, you can get kind of messy out there real quick.
And there's a pass out there. Nice play by Mox to Dutra. And Dutra's out for a gain of 13 as Ethan Marks looked like he was going to run and decided just to throw it out in the flat.
Yeah, nice play. They ran this play earlier in the year. That was the game where they blew the whistle early. So nice play. Get some open field, get a quick first down, and most importantly, out of bounds quickly.
Spot the ball at the 29-yard line. Indians trail 24-7, just under 6.5 to remaining in this one. And Marks loses control, picks it up. And now he scampers out of there. And the senior fights for yards and picks up 7. Nice play by Ethan Marks.
Well, that's a great senior move there by Ethan Marks, having been taken out of his running back position and put at quarterback. And you can see he was in trouble with this high snap. Well, it was a low snap. It went off his fingertips. And you thought for sure he's going to be sacked, but has the wherewithal to get away and turns nothing into something. Gains about 6 yards on that.
Cadence Chase on the tackle. 4 for Haven. Second down, and we'll call it 3. The ball on the Indian 36-yard line. Mox turns.
Oh.
And now they try a little trickery, and that just doesn't work out at all.
Timing's everything. I mean, you run this play in practice with Kelly, you know, and it's not that it was off time, but it's just it's somebody different. You know, I'm sure that this play was probably Kelly, Marx, and Dutra during practice all week, and unfortunately just kind of goofed up there, and the spacing seemed a little off there on that play.
Well, it was off because Dante Barati came in and broke it up at the last second. Just stuck his helmet in there, and the pitchman was nearly tackled on the pitch.
Real tough third and 12 here now for the Indians. Really forced into going to a passing game.
Fairhaven's playing 3 deep. Nearly impossible to complete a pass. And Marks, he's got plenty of time. Now he's just going to throw it out of bounds. You got 3 deep back there, Andrew. It's hard to complete a pass of
3 deep, everybody covered in short side of the field. You kind of cut half the field off when you do a rollout to the short side of the field. There's not much room, so you got 3 deep for Haven. Very easy to defend there. You just say, okay, well, no one's getting behind me on the backside. There's nobody over there, so keep everybody in front. And, you know, there was nobody really open for Dartmouth there, unfortunately.
All they really have to do is not give up the big play.
Well, this is the play here. I mean, they don't get this. This game is it's already kind of almost out of reach, but it is definitely over if they don't get this first down.
Ball's at their own 25-yard line. They trail 24-7, 4:24 remaining, and they're looking at 4th and 13. Marks, it's got time. He throws incomplete down here at the 40-yard line.
Even if that was
intended for Will Chow.
Even if that was completed, I don't know if that would have been enough for the first down. It looked like it was short from my angle over here.
And you're a defensive coordinator. You got a quarterback that's never played quarterback. He's right-handed. And the obvious thing for him is to roll right because that's where he feels comfortable. That's where a normal right-hander would feel comfortable. And that's the way that defense just played that. They had four or five guys here on this sideline.
Yeah, the cover three, the third. I mean, it's very simple when you get one of the thirds is not even mattering because he's not going to be able to get that throw off. So you just say, all right, well, we'll shove everybody over here. We got eight or nine guys over here, and we'll get you from the backside and try to beat us on your backup quarterback.
And Marks, which he's done Marks all day. Kelly. We talked about Ethan Marks, Paul. Before the game, he and Kelly combining for over 1,900 yards. And we talked about the outstanding runner in Cadence Chase. But we might have made a mistake, Paul. You and I, we don't make many. We didn't really mention Justin Marks. Quite a surprise.
Yeah, he really has done the job here for the Fairhaven Blue Devils. Another sort of, tool in the toolbox. And he's really played a tremendous Thanksgiving game here against the Dartmouth Indians. And he, Justin Marks, right, he's only a sophomore. And he had four touchdowns coming in. He has five now because of the one he had today, the 44-yard real back killer by Fairhaven earlier in the game, got into the end zone. And so look at this Fairhaven group. I mean, they got some good players coming up the ranks.
Derek Almader in his second year, rebuilding the program. Rudy Bulger there for many years. And I'm not sure he's calling this timeout to put some other players in that haven't played. It's kind of a surprising time to call timeout with 3:28 to go and you're leading in the ballgame 24-7.
Well, Justin Mark got his fifth touchdown of the season for Fairhaven. Cadence Chase got his 20th. Came in with the school record of 19. Gets another one right here on Thanksgiving Day, which I'm sure he's enjoying very much. And Colby Correa with a touchdown for Fairhaven. The only score for the Dartmouth Indians at the beginning of the game, a two-yard touchdown run by Ethan Marks, his 11th of the year. Extra point by Taradash, made it 7-0 at that time, but Fairhaven with 24 unanswered points in front of this big crowd here on Thanksgiving morning. But the injury to Will Kelly, the senior quarterback and defensive back, that was the big killer. That has resulted in a one-sided game. Really, this game was going to be probably a one-possession, one-point kind of game.
Yeah.
And after that, that was it.
Here's Chase looking for running room. Chase gets down inside the 20-yard line. Dartmouth claims the ball is loose. Nothing yet from the officials. And looks like Fairhaven's going to keep possession of the football. Dan Martin. Marcus Souza in on the stop. Indians playing.
Chow has the ball in his hands, but who knows? Looks to be, I don't know. Marks looked like he saw something early. I don't know, but I mean, from this angle, it looked like he was down. I mean,
everybody going for the ball.
2:41 to go. Hope you've enjoyed this telecast of Dartmouth High School football, the annual Thanksgiving Day matchup. It was predicted to be a close game, and once the Indian quarterback went out with a knee injury, turned the whole game around, and Chase stretching to get that first down. Guys in the truck have something for us. Let's see.
Referee standing there.
Oh, ball was out.
Ooh. And this guy standing right in the right side of your screen is.
Well, first of all, he's not.
Throws the bag. He throws the bag as a fumble.
Yeah.
Come on.
Can we look at that again?
Yeah. I mean, why do you throw the bag and then don't make the call that it was a fumble? It's beyond me. I don't understand this, but.
Well, looking back, that pass interference call against the Indians, that was a real killer. Because at that time in the game, they probably would have got the ball back there. And then Fairhaven ended up scoring a touchdown on that drive. Now, again, that was after Kelly was out. We still had, a big hill to climb and everything. But looking back at that play, that was a big play. And then, of course, Indians not capitalizing on the Marks return on special teams.
Yeah, that was a killer. That was tough,
Now we got a measurement. Let's see which way this is going to go. A lot of close ones. First down.
So my assumption is the referee threw the bag. just in case it was a fumble and one of the referees that was on top of the play, perhaps that he was down. I guess that's how you would read that.
Well, I mean, they have so many huddles throughout the game. I mean, that guy should go back and say, hey, I saw the ball come out. It's a fumble. It was a clear recovery. Chow had the ball in his hands. It wasn't like a disputed play, but you know, who knows with these rules and what's going on. But
so, Jim, you getting ready to get stuffed?
No, but this is interesting. Andrew said he threw the bag. He forgot to throw the flag. There's a penalty, so instead of throwing the flag, he threw the bag. Well, so the ball's now marched back to the 31-yard line, where it'll be first and 10 after that 2.5-minute delay.
I was just trying to get your mind off of it.
Yeah. Seen it all year. It's not a surprise at this point.
There's Marks. He's down inside the 25. Clock continues to roll.
So are you a turkey guy? Are you a stuffing guy? Are you a cranberry sauce guy?
I'm a turkey gravy.
You're a turkey?
Matt? Oh, yeah. Oh. I don't know. I've been 16, 17 years of marriage. I think you turn into something else. I don't know what it is. I know I'm clueless and mindless. I know that after all these years.
No,
I don't know about
know.
You.
I don't think so. Still sharp as a tack, Jim.
Yes, a dull one.
After that clip we saw before, that proves everything.
You ruined my whole career. Fairhaven just keeps it on the ground. Coach Almeida has got this game wrapped up. He continues to pound the ball against his Dartmouth defense. And that young fella right there, I think I might give him player of the game, number 25. What do you guys think?
Yeah, he played a great game for Fairhaven. And again, we pointed out, just a young player, a freshman, Justin Marks, 5'11", 185, is a running back, also plays linebacker. He's going to be a key guy from his positions, both offensively and defensively.
And this will be the last play of the game as Joseph brings him up to the line of scrimmage. And he'll just take a knee and the stadium clock will run out. Fairhaven joyful across the way, and why shouldn't they be? They've come in and defeated Dartmouth High School on their home turf by a score of 24-7. The kids from Fairhaven are jubilant.
First win since 2011.
I believe it's only the fourth win in the 2020s.
Right.
So a big win for Fairhaven. I wouldn't call this a devastating loss for Dartmouth. I'd just call this, they lost their best player on offense and one of their top players on defense. And not only did the wind go out of the sails in the stadium, but also the team. The team just seemed to like lose a little bit of intensity, I would say.
Yeah, right, and it's understandable. And then after that, returned by Marks, we said they got down to the 10-yard line, couldn't get in, and then it's like, wow, you know, that's a great opportunity. We may not get another opportunity like that again, and they didn't.
No, and it's, you know, high school football was a game of momentum. You know, Dartmouth had the momentum to start the game. Kelly was running the ball strong with Marks. He goes down immediately with, looked like he was untouched, and looks like a tough knee injury, but, you know, it's once Fairhaven gets a taste of that momentum, they never let up, and it was just a grind for them, and they just kind of wore you down the whole game and go 99 yards. They break on a long run. Dartmouth usually can do that to other teams. They didn't do that today, and Fairhaven took advantage, and, you know.
Another short recap, Paul Santos.
Well, yes, it was an interesting game. The Dartmouth Indians scoring on an Ethan Marks 2-yard run to make it 7-0. Then it was all Fairhaven after that, a 27-yard field goal by Tyler Burke. There was a 1-yard touchdown run by Justin Marks, a 44-yard run by Cadence Chase, his 20th of the year, and a 12-yard touchdown run by Colby Correa, 24-7 in favor of the Indians. Well, for our entire DC TV staff, it's Paul Santos, it's Andy Thompson, and it's Jim Thompson. We'd like to say happy Thanksgiving to everybody, right, Jim?
Yeah, happy Thanksgiving. We hope everyone has a safe holiday after last year with the pandemic and families not getting a chance to get together. We hope all your families in the community can get out to see your sons and daughters and grandchildren and and enjoy the day with your family. So we'll wrap it up here. The final score for the final time. Fairhaven High School 24, Dartmouth High School 7. From my broadcast partner, Paul Santos, and my son Andrew, happy Thanksgiving once again. Final score, 24 Fairhaven, 7 Dartmouth. I'm Jim Thompson. So long, everybody.